We're continuing our math review, and I've been asking Alvin about how mathematical operations on vectors and matrices work. If you haven't watched the last video on vectors, you should definitely watch that or none of this will make sense. We've been talking about matrices, but you never actually defined them. What's a matrix?
It's like a vector, but while a vector is just a column or row of numbers, a matrix has multiple rows and columns of numbers. It's a rectangle filled with a number in each cell.
This seems more complicated. There were rules on taking the dot product. Are there rules on multiplying matrices and vectors?
Yes, but it's the same rule. When we take a dot product, we're really multiplying two vectors together. It's one row vector times one column vector. The inner dimensions must match, and the result is a single number.
Wait a second, let's go back to the dot product with vectors. That wasn't the case there.
Oh, but it was. Didn't you see the transpose symbol? The transpose of a matrix reflects its values along its diagonal, flipping it on its side.
So the rows become columns and the columns become rows.
That's right. So with a vector, it'll convert a row vector to a column vector and vice versa.
Is that useful?
Well, recall that earlier we noted that we can only take the dot product of a row vector and a column vector. So to be consistent, if we want to do this, we need to technically take the transpose.
Ah, so the result is a 1x1 matrix in the end. I see. So in general, when you multiply two matrices, one of which is A by B and the other one is C by D, B and C have to be the same.
Exactly. And the result will be an A by D matrix.
Could we start with something simple, like multiplying something by one? Does something like that exist for matrix multiplication?
Yes, it's called the identity matrix. It's a matrix where all the cells are zero, but everything along the diagonal is one. Whenever you multiply something by the identity matrix, you get the same answer that you started with.
Okay, can we start by multiplying something by the identity matrix?
Okay, sure. Here's a general rule for multiplying matrices. First, start with empty cells for the result. You need an empty cell for what the dimension of the result will be. Again, it's just the first and last dimension of the two matrices. For the result cell in position ij, it's just like the dot product of the row I of the left matrix and column j of the right matrix. What's the product of the 2x2 identity matrix and the vector?
Okay, so the result will be a 2x1 matrix. That means there are only two cells we need to fill in. For the top cell, we add 1 times 3 plus 0 times 4, which is 3. And then the bottom cell is 0 times 3 plus 1 times 4, which is, as you promised, gave us back the vector 3, 4. What's next?
Okay, an identity matrix is one special kind of matrix that gives you easy answers to matrix multiplications. But we'll also run into a special form of the vector called the binary vector. Let's see what happens when you multiply a vector times a binary vector filled only with ones and zeros.
Okay, so there's this matrix with a lot more rows. And then we're going to multiply it by a vector with, phew, only a single one. Okay, first, when you transpose this into a row vector, there's only one row, and the right matrix only has two columns, so the new dimension will be 1x2. So for the first cell, I multiply just the corresponding row by 1. Okay, so that must be 6. For the second cell, it's that same row, but the other column. Ah, I see. So this just picks out the corresponding row.
So what happens when you have multiple ones?
Ah, so that would add up all of the corresponding rows.
Exactly. We'll see this later. The binary matrix can correspond to what people or words are in an example. And we select their features from a feature matrix. Then the matrix product can then stand in for the example.
Are we going to go on to products of big matrices by each other?
Not yet. We'll save that for when we actually get into deep learning function definitions. But this introduction should be enough for now.
Phew! So far we've talked about dot products, multiplication, and addition. Are there any others we should know?
The last operation we'll discuss is the inverse. Most of us probably remember what a multiplicative inverse is from algebra. The inverse of 5, for example, can be written as 5 to the negative first power, which is the same as 1 over 5. If we multiply 5 by its inverse, we get 1. This is the definition of a multiplicative inverse in arithmetic.
We also have inverse functions.
An inverse function, f inverse of x, is a function which, when f of x is its input, gives you x. So f inverse of f of x equals x. You can say it reverses the function, for example. So what would be something like this for matrices?
That would be a matrix that reverses another matrix.
Right, we call A inverse, written as A to the negative 1, the inverse of matrix A. And A times A inverse gives us the identity matrix. So that wraps up our review of matrix algebra. We'll see this in action soon as we learn about linear and logistic regression.
If you want to see more videos like this, check the video description for the course that comes from the link down below. You can then see the context and the correct order for watching these videos. YouTube will gleefully show you stuff in the wrong order. If you want other people to see this video, provide a big gradient to the recommendation algorithm by clicking the like and subscribe button down below.